imaging and tissue-based selection rather than just clear-cut time cutoffs, which is pretty fascinating. What I'll say is that here, my understanding, Dr. Bell, is that you use DWI for the ischemic core in your selection criteria, right? You don't use perfusion here.
Yeah, if you go back one slide, so in the Don trial, they effectively did not use CT perfusion. It's a little bit confusing. So they use CT perfusion, but not to ascertain the number. They only used it to define what was core. And then they also used DWI. No number estimation. What they used to estimate the number was the clinical exam, which I think is a far better tool. Think about perfusion imaging. It's meant to be a more physiologic perfusion measure. There's nothing more physiologic than comparing the clinical exam to a core in heart size. So if you have a small core, but you have a large and high stroke scale, physiologic information to have a large amount of ischemic tissue that can help. And then in diffuse 3, they did use perfusion. And I think they used a cutoff of 1.8, the Tmax of the contrast gain of the frames, like 6 seconds, and they called it ischemic, which is part of the problem with perfusion. It's not a lot. Process is arbitrary. And then the last point I wanted to point out about these two studies is that they were very aggressive with the core size that they selected. So in both studies, roughly patients who were included had core and heart sizes of around 50 cc, which is about the size of the ball. I think the diffuse 3 might have been a little bit higher, etc. Don, if you were over 80, I think they made it even more strict. That you had to have a quarter part of as small as 230 cc. And so I think that's the other important point here, is that if you're very strictly selecting people who must have great collaterals because they've had a large muscle occlusion for this long, but they had very, very tiny strokes, they're probably more likely to know. And so it's not clear to me that the perfusion would add anything in diffuse 3 because they were choosing patients with very, very small strokes.
So I guess at our institution, what ideally would happen, so then comes the question of how we use it, I guess, in our institution, because this patient that we talked about presented after 8-9 hours. Because she had an AICD, she was unable to get an MRI. But because she had, my understanding is because she had good collateral circulation, you still found her to be a candidate, right?
Right. So with the CTA or collaterals, you can get an estimate of what the core is. Mm-hmm. So a different imaging, like she had a small core that was super basic. She had great collaterals. So, you know, there's data from some of the initial 5 randomized control trials, as well as some European data that suggests that you can use the CTA collateral status to determine CANS in the absence of having a DWI, MRI, or even PPE.
So my takeaway from this as a knee physician is that, although if I read about this, I see fairly strict guidelines, even though they do talk about collaterals, they talk about a few things, but you know, they say follow this, follow this, follow that. Talk to your, obviously, get the correct imaging and talk to your neuroradiologist, neurointerventionalist, and see what they do. You know, again, this is anterior versus posterior circulation, which is not mentioned here, barely mentioned. And you know, it's not mentioned in the studies, but it is in the guidelines, but very weakly. You just, you know, talk to the neuroradiologist and see what they do and how they select their patients. So just very quickly, I mean, we talked about this. Very few patients got TPA in these two studies, and they used very particular imaging criteria. Just quickly, I wanted to reiterate the timing. Under 6 hours, large vessel occlusion, good functional baseline. Get that CT/CTA. If it's there, call your neurointerventionalist. Over 6 hours, you're supposed to get some imaging that assesses viable tissue. You know, if it's possible to get MRI, that's great. But if it's impossible, like with our patient, it's still not like an absolute contraindication. But really, delay can lead to worse outcomes. Even though, as I said, the studies were stopped early, and because of that, the subgroup analysis was difficult to do. But there is one meta-analysis in JAMA that showed that the odds ratio really goes down significantly between 3 and 6 hours, for instance. I mean, it's something that makes sense, right? Time is brain, perfusion is brain. If you delay the procedure, you're gonna probably lose more brain, and if you're not gonna be judicious with blood pressure control, and at least maintain, at the very least, the permissive hypertension that we're supposed to maintain with stroke, but also at least a normal tension if the patient is hypotensive, then you're gonna lose more brain. And, you know, so the fact that there's extended windows doesn't mean that we have all the time in the world to get them to the IR suite. We still have to be pretty emergent about this. TPA, we talked about, controversial. All the studies used it. It's because of that, it's really hard to interpret what it means. Compared to TPA, we don't have that. It also makes it hard to interpret the complications that the ICHs happen because it was done with TPA or without. Again, the subgroup analyses aren't very powerful, and the meta-analyses, because they were stopped early. But hopefully, in the future, we'll have studies comparing TPA to mechanical thrombectomy and not the combination. But again, and this is in the AHA guidelines, is that there's benefit in thrombectomy even if they don't meet criteria for TPA. So if they come in and they have a contraindication for TPA, still think of thrombectomy. So just keep this in your mind now, because this is something we need to be aware of, okay? In the guidelines, TPA, give it, that's what they say. This is HAASA, so this is not our, you know, but anyway, I'll just keep it there. I'm not gonna go any deeper into that. If the patient meets specific criteria for thrombectomy is recommended. The word specific, I guess, is in there, even though I think we have a little bit more flexibility. It may be reasonable with occlusion of smaller vessels, anterior, vertebral, basilar, and PCA. So don't ignore it just because it's not in all these studies. If you're very evidence-based and just read these studies and decided that they weren't included, they're really important, and again, very devastating is ischemic stroke. Over 6 hours, use the Dunn and diffuse criteria, which only means that you're gonna probably have to get more imaging, if possible. And reduced time to perfusion is associated with good outcomes. That's in the guidelines, so, yeah. That's it. I'm gonna skip this. We talked about this way too many times, the inclusion criteria. Hopefully, they're kind of in your brain, large vessel occlusion, proven on CTA with a moderate deficit and a good baseline. That's where you should start, and just think of that CTA. Get it early. Call your neurointerventionist early if you do have a patient who meets the criteria. And just kind of think of this tissue-based selection in your patients. Any questions?
I know that because of these trials, I think Dr. Law was talking about maybe changing the stroke codes in the 24 hours.
That's a big question for us, right? That's a big, so, you know, I think stroke codes, good and bad, right? Like we saw with this case, stroke codes can make you numb, right? You're like, okay, they're in the window, I call a stroke code, and then I'll let the neuro drive. And then you don't necessarily think about what we're supposed to do. So that could be a really good thing, but I think we're gonna see, most likely we're gonna see changes in our protocols in how we approach stroke, because now, you know, the stroke codes are all based on TPA, right? So before TPA, we didn't really have that kind of emergent treatment, and now we have something that seems better. So we're gonna see, hopefully we're gonna see good changes in protocols. I don't know if anybody's aware of something that's happening, but I'm not.
Maybe one or two more questions, anyone? Okay.
I'm sorry, I missed what was being said about the
HA
the tissue available at the clinical exam, do you have a correlation?
Yeah, So the Dawn trial, what they did is they looked at the size of the core, and then they looked at the deficit, and they wanted to see a mismatch. What they wanted to see is a small ischemic core, dead tissue, and a larger deficit. And they wanted to see a mismatch between those two, because what this means is you have ischemic tissue. You have tissue that is lacking perfusion, that's giving you a deficit, but it's not dead yet, because on the MRI, it's smaller. And that's the mismatch they're looking for, right? Does that make sense? I guess what Dr. Bell is saying, that the correlation between the deficit on the exam and the tissue that's lost perfusion right now is a pretty good measure of ischemic tissue, but the ischemic core, which is dead tissue that will not be saved, you have to find on the MRI. You need a mismatch between those two. Okay, does that make sense?
A mismatch shows collaterals.
It means collateral, pretty much. That's the bottom line. It means collateral circulation, yeah.
Can I show a couple slides?
Yeah, please.
We're going to get to CBL. Everybody ready?